Starting with the Donkey Kong Country trilogy, I became a devoted fan of British developer Rare, who went on to develop some of the most spectacular games of the N64 era. Back then, it seemed like Rare's titles would be a major part of Nintendo consoles forever. But in the days following Rare's first and only GameCube release, it was announced that Microsoft bought the company. I wanted to continue playing Rare's games, but I was in college and an Xbox just didn't make sense at the time. Well, I've told this story before, and you may have seen that in the past couple of years, I've finally started to get into the Xbox consoles, with one of my major plans being to finally play through all of Rare's post-Nintendo titles, and decide for myself if they really did lose their touch under Microsoft, as seems to be the general consensus slash assumption. Well, in previous episodes, I discovered that Grabbed by the Ghoulies is actually super fun. And Conker, well, Conker was pretty much exactly what I expected. Overall, not a terrible start to my Rare after Nintendo journey. But now, it's time to move on to the Xbox 360, and first up is Kameo Elements of Power. My GameCube was purchased on launch day in November 2001. The back of the box shows screenshots from three games in development at Rare, only one of which, Star Fox Adventures, was ever released for the console. Donkey Kong Racing never happened, but then there's Kameo Elements of Power, a game whose development history spans three generations and four different consoles. Work on Kameo began when, following the release of Donkey Kong 64, the team started experimenting with a monster-catching training concept, which was, of course, all the rage. An evolved version of the idea was later shown off in the earliest GameCube previews, a game where Kameo, the fairy protagonist, would morph into various creatures and improve their abilities. Nintendo Power proudly placed the game in their list of upcoming GameCube titles, alongside other sure-to-be classics like Duke Nukem Forever and Retro Studios' Ravenblade. Well, in retrospect, that was ill omen enough. But following the Microsoft buyout, Rare didn't give up on Kameo, moving development to the Xbox and creating what is believed to be an almost finished game. In fact, thanks to the recovery efforts of some Assembler Games Forums members, a shockingly advanced development build has been dumped and is playable on soft-modded Xbox consoles. But it wouldn't be until 2005 when Kameo would at long last emerge from her tumultuous development cocoon as an Xbox 360 launch game. The Xbox 360 is the first home console that enforced HD resolutions as standard, at a time when the idea of owning an HD TV still seemed very unlikely to most people. Kameo was, of course, supposed to show off the 360's power, but much of the geometry appears to be very similar to the Xbox development build. Stylized designs, advanced texture effects, and Rare's ambitious standards have helped Kameo remain, overall, a beautiful game to this day. Dated, but more impressive than you might expect. I'm a sucker for grass effects, and honestly, you don't see it done quite this well very often, even today. I mean, look at 2016. B+ for effort, but next time I want to see you really embrace that glorious tall grass aesthetic like Rare did in 2005. But even more striking is the borderline gratuitous use of parallax occlusion mapping applied liberally across nearly every surface possible, giving textures a great deal of perspective and depth. Kameo is the younger fairy princess from the Enchanted Kingdom, granted the power of transformation magic from her mother, the queen, much to the frustration of the older princess, Callus. In a fit of revenge, Callus revives the troll warlord Thorn, reigniting a conflict between the fairies and trolls. So, wait, hold on. What's this? Oh. Incoming memo from Microsoft here. Ah, pardon me, Kameo is an elf princess, not a fairy princess. That sissy stuff you read about the GameCube version is just dead wrong. Well, okay, sure. Elves can have fairy wings and not be fairies. Fair enough. Anyway, Kameo, who is definitely an elf waging an epic war against battle-hungry trolls and not a fairy who could offend the target audience's manhood, fails at a brash attempt to rescue her family from Thorn's stronghold and must travel the tribal lands to properly recruit all 10 elemental warriors, those being the creatures that she transforms into. On her way to the different regions of the tribal lands, Kameo travels through the Badlands, where a huge battle is continually being fought between elves and trolls. In the original Xbox version, the Enchanted Kingdom was planned to serve as the main hub area, but in the final release, the portals are closed off until later. So the Badlands are basically a second hub, the primary purpose of which is to make you go gee whiz at just how many trolls the mighty Xbox 360 can push through. At predetermined points in the game, key strategic locations in the Badlands come under heavy attack, and Kameo must aid in their defense, or else the barrier protecting the Enchanted Kingdom in the sky will fall and the game will be over. These aren't necessarily the best parts of the game, but while the whole thing is rather tacked on, I'll admit that it's nice that they were able to make the conflict feel very tangible, even if the dev team was probably just riding on the early 2000s Lord of the Rings high. So otherwise, there are three main areas, and this is where the bulk of the game takes place: the forest region, water region, and snow region. Each area has its own tribe with very different looks, I guess? Kameo must complete her tasks in these areas before she'll be ready to return to Thorn's domain. My initial vibe with Kameo was that it felt more like a follow-up to Star Fox Adventures than anything else, but Kameo is shorter on puzzles and heavier on combat. Combat really is the make-or-break area for Kameo, and I think it generally succeeds. Kameo herself is not a strong combatant, but the creatures she transforms into all have wildly differing movesets. While there are times that you must use a particular creature and ability, you're often able to freely switch between elemental warriors on the fly and fight however you like. Your first creature, Pummelweed, is more of a one-on-one combatant, while the dragon Ash is good for dealing rapid damage to multiple enemies as long as you aren't being heavily flanked. Some creatures are good at disposing of enemies off a cliff, while others have more oddball fighting styles that take getting used to. A later game elemental warrior, Thermite, can even strafe and fire bombs. You can equip up to three elemental warriors to X, Y, and B, while the A button always transforms back to Kameo, who is generally just easier to get around as. All abilities for all elemental warriors are performed in some fashion by the use of the R and L triggers, or pressing them simultaneously. Ultimately, it's pretty simple, but can also be challenging. Controls are okay, but certainly not perfect, and don't quite jive with more modern button mapping conventions. Some elemental warriors are tougher to use in combat, but are essential to getting around, like the armadillo Major Ruin, who can roll up curved slopes, or Deep Blue, who provides the only way to travel underwater. You can acquire upgrades and new abilities for each creature by consuming elemental fruit found throughout the game world, which feels like the last remnant of the old monster training concept. All of this builds a strong base for the game. The execution is far from perfect, but it's mostly enjoyable. Some aspects of the game don't quite come together, with Rare not fully excising some of the bones of early development. For example, most of the elemental warriors are freed by completing these extremely messy battles with shadow trolls, at which time they appear as babies, and then immediately take their ultimate form. It's like Rare just had a hard time letting go of that monster evolution they originally envisioned, but it's weird to see it appear this way in the final product. There's also talk in-game of Kameo possessing an object called the Element of Power, the freaking namesake of the game, and as far as I saw, it's never obviously shown or explained. Maybe it's the shield-like object on the GameCube box? Kameo may have never become the game that Rare had originally imagined it might be, but I'd say that they ended up making an above-average game that's still worth a look for anyone who enjoyed Rare's work on the N64. Kameo took me a little over 10 hours to play through, so it didn't outstay its welcome like some of Rare's more ambitious N64 adventures admittedly could. You can, of course, also emulate Kameo on the Xbox One via Rare Replay or the backwards compatibility function. For all these years following the launch of the Xbox 360, I'd been under the impression that Kameo was, on one hand, largely forgotten, on the other, still generally considered one of Rare's better titles developed under Microsoft ownership. For me, I'd have to say that the core gameplay is definitely not as fun as Grabbed by the Ghoulies, but it's a solid enough middle-of-the-road Rare title. Now, Kameo shipped to stores about a week before the Xbox 360 released, but there was another Rare game available on launch day, which of course we'll have to wait for another time.